I want to tell you that I'm so glad that you're here with us today. And before we jump into things today that we're going to be talking about, I want to say that next weekend is going to be, I think, a real special weekend around here. If you were around in the month of March, in early April, then you remember that we talked a lot about an initiative that we've just called our For the One efforts. And our For the One initiative, it's all about the ways that we believe that God might be leading us into the future as a church. And part of our For the One efforts has been to raise the resources needed to take new ground as we move forward as a church into the future. And next week, we're going to give you an update about where we are with our For the One efforts, and you are not going to want to miss next weekend. We've got a lot to celebrate. And I just want to tell you, too, that if you haven't jumped in, you want to be a part of it, you want to get more information about it, it's not too late to jump in and be a part of our For the One effort. You can just go to our website, and you can see everything you need to know there. That's coming up next weekend. This weekend, I'm very excited for our time together right now. You know, over the last few weeks, we've been talking through the book of Revelation. And we have gotten so much positive feedback about this series over the last several weeks. And one of the things that's just struck me as we've been walking through the book of Revelation is that this is a book of hope, not fear. And we've been reminded over the last several weeks as we've been working through Revelation that, man, we can have hope that Jesus Christ is still in control and is coming back. And at a real practical level, that reality that he's in control and he's coming back, that reality, it can breathe new life and new purpose into the days that we live right now. Not just waiting for one day, but right now we can have new life and new purpose. And we want to be a church. I mean, that's kind of a heartbeat of ours. We want to be a church that lives differently today in light of the future. And one of the ways that works itself out for us here at LCBC is just in the way that we care for our communities. Not just across the state of Pennsylvania, but in some of the most under-resourced communities around the world. You know, about 15 years ago, we made a decision as a church to begin partnering with organizations who were doing exceptional work all over the world. And we wanted to find ways that we could come alongside them as a church and do good together. And in particular, we found that child sponsorships, working with organizations that are doing child sponsorships, us being involved with child sponsorships, that has been one of the most effective ways at delivering care to communities around the world and to lead people to Jesus in those communities. And so here's some remarkable numbers I'll just share with you real quick. This is kind of amazing, and it's worth celebrating. We're currently, right now, our church is currently working in 6 of the most under-resourced countries around the world on 4 different continents. And in those 6 countries, our church currently sponsors 6,961 children around the world. And if you're not going to clap for that, I'm going to, because I'm super proud of that. I'm super proud of you, because when I talk about our church, that's you. I hope you know that. That's you. That's almost 7,000 children who are having their lives changed, man, because you've stepped up and decided you're going to do something about it. You know, one of the organizations that we partner with is Compassion International. And we've been working with Compassion International in Bolivia for over 10 years now. And Compassion International, it's one of the largest humanitarian organizations in the world, providing sponsorship to over 2.2 million children across the world. And I am so grateful to have the President Emeritus of Compassion International, Wess Stafford, here with us today. Wess joined the staff of Compassion International in 1977, 45 years of faithfully leading and serving at Compassion. He served as president and CEO for 2 decades, for 20 years, at Compassion. Wess knows how to lead. He knows how to lead. He knows how to lead at the highest levels, aligning a multinational organization around a clear and compelling vision. But so much more important than his leadership chops, which he has, it's his heart. It's his heart for the poor and the oppressed in our world. He has been a fearless advocate for the poor and vulnerable for decades. And if you lean in today, I believe you're going to find your own heart inspired by what God is doing in this world. And you may just find yourself challenged to consider how God might be inviting you to join him in that work. So LCBC, no matter where you are right now, would you help me give a very warm LCBC welcome to Wess Stafford?
Grateful. Thanks, Jason. LCBC, what a wonderful, wonderful church. What a joy to be with you and to actually see you face to face. I've heard about you, never been here before, but I've heard about you and the things I've heard, the way God has blessed you, 19 campuses, the way you're blessing Eastern Pennsylvania. I figured when I finally get to see you, you're all gonna be like superheroes, 10 feet tall and able to leap buildings in a single bound. And I'm a little bit relieved to see you face to face now and realize that, no, you're not that big. I don't have to be afraid of you. And then I understood why people say what they say about you when I walked up here on the stage for the first time. And I saw the names that you have written up here. Your friends, your neighbors, your family, that you are trusting God in his own time and his own way to bring into the kingdom. And the way you're growing is because you are leading people to Christ. You are living out the very name of this great church. I think every church should be called LCBC. I think every church should say that we are living lives that were changed by Christ. And I've been here and I'm thrilled to watch you in this, thrilled to speak with you. Appreciate Jason, appreciate your pastor, Dave, the years of consistent shepherding that you've had. And I can see how they have shaped your hearts to care for the poor and to reach out not only here in your Jerusalem, but across the 19 campuses, you guys, and ultimately across the world, sure enough. So yeah, 7,000 children sponsored by you guys. How many of you say, yeah, I'm one of them? I'm one of them. Whoa! Okay, so this turns into a shareholders meeting. I had no idea. And you're doing it with World Vision, and you're doing it with Food for the Hungry, and I know that you're doing it some with Compassion. I know the church that you launched down in Cochabamba, Bolivia. You funded that place. That church is launched with a child development center in it. You sponsored every child in that center and just about every child within walking distance of that church, well over 1,000 of them. And then when I drove on your campus in from the south entrance, I come to what I think is your whole church, only to read the writing on the wall. It says kids ministry. And I'm like, wait a minute, I'm like coming home. These people believe in children just like I do. And so I'm thrilled to be here. You have to understand that normally when I'm out speaking, I'm not talking to people who already understand the importance of ministry to children. I'm usually at a conference somewhere, and I'm talking to theologians and missiologists and mission executives, and they're sitting there like, we're talking about what? Children? Why don't we talk about something important? And I'm like, this is important, and this is going to be more important. So they forced me to be Dr. Stafford. They forced me to come up with my statistics and my strategies and my scriptural mandate. But today, I don't have to do that. This feels like vacation for me. Instead of convincing you of the importance of ministry to children, I want to encourage you in what you're already doing, and then maybe arm you a little bit for the battle so that you can influence other people to think the way you do. So I think the least of these matter most. And ever since the disciples shooed the children away from Jesus 2,000 years ago, the church has behaved with its budget, with its priorities, with its strategies, as if in Matthew 25, when Jesus, that great teacher, said those powerful words, whatever you have done for one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. We behave as if he skipped a word in there inadvertently. What he meant to say, we think, is whatever you've done for one of the least important of these. But that isn't what he was saying, and he knew exactly what he was saying. When he said, what you've done for the least of these, he meant what you've done for the poor, what you've done for the marginalized, what you've done for the vulnerable, then you did it for me. He surely meant the smallest, of course, and the weakest and the youngest. He probably also meant those who can't speak for themselves, those who can't protect themselves, those who can't care for themselves. When you do something for one of them, you've done it for me. Those who are least able to thank you, those who are least able to reward you, those who are least able to honor you the way you deserve to be honored, for caring for them. Then Jesus is saying, mysteriously and wonderfully in that chapter, you were doing it for me. Teacher, that little one, that little guy that you will not give up on, someday you'll hear Jesus say, that was me, surprise. Policeman, that little girl that you protected, yeah, that was Jesus. Those tears you dried from that little cheek, you're going to understand. Jesus said, those were my tears. And I felt that much needed hug. And even that child you sponsored all the way across the world that you never actually saw, that was me. And that Matthew 25, verse 40 judgment, the sheep and the goats, you know the story of that judgment. That judgment is actually going to happen. And it's going to come one trumpet blast from now. And the dark glass is going to be removed in that moment. The veil is going to be pushed aside. And we are all going to see the kingdom. And we are going to understand the heart of our God in that moment. And there's going to be a lot of surprises. Who we thought was important all this time aren't going to be all that important in the upside down kingdom that we belong to. And what we thought was important is going to suddenly seem pretty silly compared to what we now understand standing before our Lord. We're going to understand that the little, in fact, all this time, were big. And that those of you who blessed the little children, you actually touched the very heart of God. I think a lot like D.L. Moody. I love the story of D.L. Moody. He was the founder of Moody Bible Institute, one of the schools that I graduated from back in the 1800s, a great evangelist. And as he was climbing into bed after an evangelistic service one evening, his wife, Emma, rolled over. Apparently, she hadn't gone that night. She rolled over and she said, well, how did it go tonight, Dwight? And he said, well, pretty good. 2.5 converts. And Emma thought for a second. She says, okay, that's a very cute way to put it. How old was the child? And he said, no, Emma. It was 2 children and 1 adult. The children have their whole lives in front of them. It's the adult who's half gone. We think like that at Compassion. I've thought like that most of my life. D.L. Moody led 1 million people to Christ during his lifetime. And over half of them were children. And on his deathbed, he said, if I had my life to live over again, I would dedicate it entirely in ministry to children. In the 1800s, D.L. Moody was way out of step with the theologians and the professors of his day. And sadly, he would still be out of step with what's going on in the world today. But I maintain he understood the harvest that we're trying to reach. He understood that of the sea of humanity on our world today, over half of them are children. So here you have half the harvest at the prime time to be harvested. We know now from missiologists that 85% of people who give their lives to Christ do it while they are children, between the ages of 4 and 14. We've coined the phrase the 4-14 window. Let me do a little research here. How many of you would say, well, that was my story. I gave my life to Christ when I was between 4 and 14. Raise your hands really high. Look around you. That's amazing. How many of you accepted Christ after you were 20 years old? George Barna was on Compassion's board for many years. He used to tell us, if a person has not accepted Christ by age 20, the probability that they ever will accept Christ as their Savior is only a 6% probability. So those of you who just raised your hand, you should run out and buy a lottery ticket or something. I mean, you have beaten the odds, and it's nice to have you in the kingdom. But here's the issue when it comes to little ones. Less than 10% of most mission efforts is bringing children to Christ and discipling them. And you guys are unusual here with your passion for children, but most churches spend less than 15% of their budget on reaching children and discipling children. I don't know about you, I'm not a rocket scientist, but we're not going to bring in the harvest like that. We're not going to build the kingdom. And if we miss this part of the harvest, we're going to miss the very heart of God. So I began to wonder, how could we not all see this? How could we not know this? And my first thought was, well, maybe because there's just not enough of them. I mean, small segments of society often get overlooked by the group. But no, as I said, they're half of humanity. So that can't be it. So maybe they're unimportant, or maybe they're only half as important as us grown-ups, because they're only like half our size. I can tell you this, my 5-foot wife can make quite a case why size has nothing to do with importance and influence. I wondered, could it be that it's just all too complicated? We need more of us to get PhDs in this very complicated field of child development. And then as I look out at you, I'm like, I don't think so. As I look at you, I see every single one of you is a child development expert. Let me do another little bit of research. How many of you have ever been a child? Oh, yeah. You spent 18 years of your life doing nothing but being a child. That's 9,500,000 minutes of just childhood. We don't need to know anything more. We know plenty. Every person I ever met either is a child or was a child. I've wondered, was God maybe silent about their importance? But you go through scriptures and it's so clear. Let the children come to me, he said very strongly. And they said, train up a child in the way he should go. When they're old, they won't depart from it. And don't you dare cause one of these little ones to stumble. Clearly the heart of God is clear there. But I wonder if maybe scriptures are a little vague on how God actually views them. And I've discovered that God loves and he respects and he uses children. All through scripture, whenever a child is mentioned, usually God is up to something important, probably something too important to entrust to one of us grown-ups, because we know too much, or we think too much. Or maybe the big problem is we think we know too much. But if you go through scripture, when God needed to kill a wicked giant, he didn't choose big, strong warriors. He chose a little boy in his sling. I'll make the case a little later on that Goliath didn't have a prayer, outgunned as he was by that little boy. When he needed to speak to the high priest who could no longer talk to, Eli, he chose a pure little channel, a little boy, Samuel, to sell it to Eli. And actually, he didn't say, Eli, please be good. He said, Eli, you and your sons are finished. God knew he could entrust the pink slip to his high priest, to a little boy. Jesus taught in the temple when he was 12 years old. I believe Jesus waited until a little boy came forward with his 5 loaves and 2 fishes before he fed the 5,000 people. I think he did that miracle for that little boy whose name we don't even know. One of us grown-ups would say, excuse me, I'm the only Eagle Scout who thought to bring lunch. You can have part of it. You can have like 2 loaves and 1 fish. But only a little child would say, Lord, if I gave you everything I have, would that be enough? And God did that for that little boy, I believe. And all through scripture, you see that. If you read my book, Too Small to Ignore, you'll see a whole chapter on just the children throughout scriptures. So I've come to the conclusion after 45 years of ministry among children, that the reason they are a second-rate mandate, the reason why they are almost always at the end of the line, is that there is spiritual warfare going on over each and every child. Yeah, the church and missions may overlook them, but they're between the greatest forces in all of the universe. There is a battle raging over each and every child, between the hosts of heaven and the hosts of hell. Satan determined to destroy these little ones, and we know from scripture that all of heaven stands up and rejoices when one little one comes in. And Satan knows the heart of God. He is in the business of trying to break God's heart. So I'm convinced he watches as each little child is knit in their mama's womb, looking for any way to attack. The womb has become now the most dangerous place to be a child, because of this kind of attack. But then when a little child is safely born, Satan changes his tactics, and he uses 2 things to try to destroy and separate a child from God. He uses poverty, and he uses comfort, or the pursuit of comfort. Both of them separate us from God. I have been back and forth across this world, sometimes on a weekly basis. And on one Sunday, I'm worshiping with a group of poverty-stricken people under a mango tree. And I'm over there to comfort the afflicted. And then I come back to my country, and I'm sitting in a fancy place, and I'm here now afflicting the comforted. And the trick is to do that with the same love that Christ did. I've discovered over these years that the worst thing about poverty is not water, it's not hygiene, it's not sanitation, it's not housing, it's not even money. The truth is, if you can take a picture of it, it's not poverty. It's probably a symptom of poverty. It's the kind of evil, destructive stuff that hangs around where poverty reigns. Because what poverty ultimately is about is a message that gets into the heart of even a little child that says, give up. Nothing's going to ever change. Nobody cares. Nobody's coming to your rescue. Just give up. That is a message straight from hell. One of the reasons Compassion works with the local church is I believe that the greatest weapon against poverty is not taking away the symptoms of it, but bringing a child to a relationship with their Heavenly Father. The strength of the gospel is in the midst of all of this. This is the path out of poverty, and I've watched it for 45 years. A child comes to a little Compassion center. They're small, they have been beat up, they don't think they matter, you can see the sparkle gone out of their eyes, the made in the image of God gone in their hearts, and they come into the project dejected, giving up before they've even began. And what that little local church does, and we only work through a church to touch the life of a child, but one of that little church does is it says to that little child, don't you believe that? You matter. You matter to us. You matter to God. He knows your name. He knows how many hairs are on your head. He knows the pattern of your fingerprints. He knit your DNA in your mama's womb. He would have died on the cross if you were the only child on earth. And all the way across the world is a sponsor chiming in saying, me too. I think you matter. I'm reading your letters. I'm looking at your pictures. I believe in you. Don't give up, sweetheart. Just don't give up. And I've watched this over many years. The child goes from, oh, wait a minute. If all that's true, then maybe I matter. And when a child says, I think maybe I matter, you are on the first step out of poverty. And what we do is we surround that child with activities. We feed them in the church. We help them with their homework. They win a blue ribbon. They get into a soccer team. They learn how to sing. And suddenly they say, you know what? If I matter, then apparently what I think must matter. And we're right there. We say, you're right, sweetheart. So what's going on? What are you thinking? What's going on in your little heart? Can you sing it with me on this guitar? Can you paint it on this easel? Can you write it in a letter to your sponsor all the way across the world? And you can see them just begin to flourish as they realize they matter and what they think matters. They've tasted a little bit of success. And then they become adolescents. And we all know adolescents. And it is so fun to watch them because now they've experienced some success and they're very sure of themselves. And they'll say, okay, I know you care what I think. You want to know what I think? I'll tell you what I think. And this is where poverty finally is defeated. They say, you see how my community is? I don't think the community should look like that. That's wrong. You see how that guy just treated her? That's not how people should treat each other. And you see that over there? That's wrong. And I think I can fix that. When a child goes from I am a victim and nothing can change to I can make my world a better place, you have just won the war on poverty. And church, the lovely thing about it is it begins with the love of God and it ends with the love of God lived out in our world today. I've watched it for 45 years. So I've never met someone who champions children who doesn't have a pretty powerful reason for why they do. And I'd like to share with you, with the time that's left, why I care. Why would I give 45 years of my life fighting on behalf of children, awakening the church as best I can to the importance of ministry to children? My battle for children began a long, long time ago. Back, I think, when God was knitting me in my mama's womb, I'm pretty sure the angels were giving all kinds of advice. I would do this, I would do that. When I was finally born, they must have sat back and said, okay, he's really cute, But he's not a rocket scientist. We're going to have to make it clear what he's to do with his life. And so I got born into the family of Ken and Marge Stafford. Ken and Marge were childhood sweethearts in Denver, Colorado. Ken was a shy farm boy, and Marge was an outgoing cheerleader at the biggest high school in Denver. They couldn't have been further apart personality-wise. The only thing that drove them together was they went to the same church, Judson Memorial Baptist Church. A place called Judson, you could imagine, had quite a missionary emphasis. So they had a parade of missionaries that came through that church. And the guys from Africa, you know, they'd roll out their 20-foot python and they'd show their jar of scorpions they'd knocked out of their boot. And Ken and Marge would nudge each other and say, not us, we're not doing that. And they used to pray when they finally got into college, please, Lord, do not call us to be missionaries. And if you do, please, not Africa. So I was born to a missionary couple assigned to Africa. Be careful what you pray for. And not just Africa, but a hot, dusty little outpost on the Sahara Desert of Ivory Coast, West Africa. I was a typical missionary kid, ran around barefoot all the time. I spoke four languages, but none of them very well: English, French, Senufu, and Julo, all of them confused. Slingshot around my neck at all times, deadly accurate with that thing. Skinny as a rail, sickly, nearly died about a half a dozen times during my childhood. Malaria nearly took me out. I'll tell you what I came closest to that nearly killed me was ants. Army ants nearly killed me when I was 9 years old. They used to come in a stream of millions of them, and everything had to get out of its way. We kept our beds in cans of kerosene to keep them off of our beds. But one night, I kicked my sheet off in the heat of the tropical night, and they came up the sheet, and they got all over me. I was completely covered with ants. They don't just pinch army ants. They inject poison. So I felt one go across my cheek, and I swatted it, thinking it was a mosquito. Apparently, that was the rule. Okay, now everybody, get him. So I was bitten hundreds of army ants all over me. I swelled up like the Michelin man. The whole village gathered around and prayed for the little white kid that he wouldn't die from ants. And I did survive. I think I may have had some long-term suffering from this, but I survived it. And now if you don't have a cause, by the way, you can join me in this cause. Step on every ant that you see. It'll take me a lifetime to get even with those things. I will go across the street if I think there's an ant hill over there on that sidewalk over there. It was a tough place to grow up. My sister and I were the only white children for 100 miles in any direction. Typical day, you can imagine, on the desert. It was 120 degrees. We were remote. We had no electricity. Obviously, no radio, no television. We had no refrigerator. My poor cheerleader mom used to stand, I remember so clearly, she used to stand at their little Tupperware bowl, looking out across the shimmering desert, washing dishes, sweat dripping off her nose. She would blow her hair out of her face, and she would say, "Way out of here, I don't have much in the way of luxury, but I do have running water. Wes, get the bucket, run out to the well and get water." And I would lug back and forth. I was the running water in our little family way out there on the prairie. No indoor plumbing, an outhouse 30 yards away, the scariest 30 yards on planet Earth. You could literally die between the house and the outhouse if you went out at night. My father was a missionary linguist. He put the Senufu language into writing, painstakingly then translated scriptures. When I was 7 years old, I was teaching Africans how to read their own language as my father was translating. You can imagine, I could barely read myself, but I could read better than anybody for 100 miles in any direction. And so I was a missionary as far as I was concerned. My father and I, hand in hand, me reaching up, I was so small, hand in hand went into villages to open them up to the gospel where no white people had been since the slave traders. And I remember people looking at the color of our skin and just screaming and running away. But when we had won their confidence, I was there to watch Africans hear the name Jesus for the first time. And I was there as they made the decisions to take the Jesus road, as they put it, just like what you're praying for your friends up here. They had a saying in our little village, it takes the whole village to raise a child. And it wasn't just a plaque on the wall, it's how we lived. Every child belonged to every grown-up in the village. And I was the wrong color. I was the only white one other than my sister. But it didn't matter to them. They considered me their child and they cared for me. They guided me. I never fell down as a little boy without some African woman swooping in, picking me up, drying my eyes. I didn't get away with a lot of no-nos because I had all these grown-ups who thought I was their kid, and I'm white and no one else is, and I'm standing out. So I remember one time the village gathered around and the chief was talking and he says, you know, I'm noticing the goats are a little bit skinny here now, and it's not because we're in a drought, it's because the little boys are chasing them all around. And in the swirling red dust, I don't know who all the culprits are, but I do know this, a little white boy right there, that's one of them right there. And I used to pray every night, dear Lord, and I know you can do this. You parted the Red Sea. You brought down the walls of Jericho. In the morning when I wake up, let my skin be black like all of my friends. And I would wake up in the morning. First thing I'd check is, still white, but maybe tomorrow. They taught me what they taught their children. I was just another village boy. I learned how to hunt. I learned how to fish. By the time I was 15 years old, I was a fully trained peasant farmer that could have raised a family. One of the great joys of being an agricultural kid in a village was you had big grown-up jobs even though you're small. And one of the jobs that us little boys had was with a sling, keeping the baboons out of the cornfields at harvest time. Baboons could get it. They weren't hungry. They just wanted to mess with it. They were monkeying around. And we would build a platform at the edge of the cornfield, and it was our job all night long to stand watch. And so we had a sling. This is actually my sling from my childhood, which would be identical what David used, putting a big old rock in here. This is what we, how us little guys would fight. So where's the target? How about the camera back there? Are you ready? Uh-oh. Okay, that was a marshmallow. But you cannot trust a marshmallow. We used to be deadly accurate with these things. I remember my mom teaching us about David and Goliath. And all of us little marksmen were sitting there under this mango tree with our weapons over our shoulders like this. And she was giving us the story that this is a story of a little boy and a lot of faith. And we were sitting there thinking, no, we don't think so. We think that's a story of a very stupid giant who let a little boy with one of these things get that close. And I used to lie in my bed at night thinking, I could have done that. He's 9 feet tall. He's got a forehead as big as a dinner plate. There's no reason why I couldn't have knocked that big boy down. We found a palm tree and we with a machete, we cut out what we thought was the size of his forehead. And then we just slayed Goliath every day. We got to the point where you had to be running while you did it because it was too easy to do it just standing there. I remember the day that tree just finally gave up. Too many little boys, too many rocks. The Africans taught me about love. They taught me about joy. They taught me about hope, that time should be your servant. I learned to be generous. The worst thing you could be was selfish in my little village. I look up to the poor. I don't even subtly look down. Everything I needed to know to lead Compassion's worldwide ministry, I learned in that little village from the poor. But we were poor, and we lost many of our little friends to what I later learned was poverty. By the time I was 15 years old and finally came to America to live, half of my little buddies had died. And I thought that's how the world works. I saw it in the animal kingdom. The old and the young are vulnerable. But I didn't know that it was something called poverty that was breaking my heart. We had to bury them the same day they died because we had no electricity, no way to embalm them. And so having lost them in my arms in 1 minute, we were putting them in the ground that evening and celebrating their life as a child. And I would go to bed early. I could listen to the drums. I understood the beats, how they communicated. And night after night, I cried myself to sleep in the hot tropical night as I lost friend after friend to what I learned was something called poverty. Finally, I come to America at age 15. First place I see in America is New York City. Can you imagine going from a little dusty jungle or desert village to New York City? I walked into New York City, these big high buildings. I saw people walking along with big paper bags, brown paper bags, and I looked inside. It was food. So being a pretty darn good hunter, I backtracked them and I came to my first grocery store. And I walked in there and I saw all of this food and it hit me. There's plenty of food. And I looked next door and it was a pharmacy. And I realized, you know what, there's plenty of food, there's plenty of medicine. My friends did not need to die. And I sat out in front of that place and I just wept and I wept and I wept. A lifetime of loss throughout childhood. It was New York City, so nobody even stopped to say, hey, are you okay, little guy? And I ran out of tears finally. And then I started just watching people walking by and I saw the fancy shoes and the purses and the watches and I just burned and I said, what is wrong with you people? You have all of this and you don't care. And I went into a rage that lasted all through my high school years in America until I had lived here for about 8 years. And once I had lived here for a while, I realized, you were wrong, Wes. It's not that they don't care. They don't know. And when they know, they really, really care. No more generous people in all of history. And I thought, somehow my life, because I know children and I know their families in poverty, and now I know these wonderful people who may have some money in their pockets, but they need what these people have. They need love and hope and joy. And these people need food and medicine. And somehow I thought, I've got to bridge these worlds. I don't know how I do that. Maybe I have to be an ambassador of some kind. About that time, I stumbled into a little storefront in Chicago, about the size of a 7-Eleven store, and it said Compassion International. And I wandered in there and I said, what are you guys about? And they said, well, our enemy is poverty. And I'm like, I know all about that. Yeah, what else? What do you do about it? And they said, well, we link little children and their family and churches with people on this side of the world who care and love them and encourage them. And I thought, good Lord, it already exists. I don't have to start anything. It already happened. So 45 years ago, I threw my hat in the ring, and I have never, never looked back. So you know my battle. You know my cause. You know my mission. You know why I have cared all of these years. And the question I have for you is, so what is your cause? Everybody needs a cause, something not about you, something outside of you, something bigger than you, something that can move you to tears in 30 seconds, either tears of great sorrow at the hurts or great joy at the victories. And if you don't have something like that in your life, I beg you, don't live like that. We don't have time for you to live like that. If you don't have a cause, and I see that you do, every one of you have a cause, those who wrote your names down here, then I would encourage you today to take my cause. Join me in the fight against poverty. Join me in the battle against what's holding back the little ones. And I know the magnitude of the problem is huge, and it's easy to be overwhelmed and paralyzed by just the sheer magnitude. Yeah, maybe you can't change the whole world, but today you could do a miracle, and you could change the whole world for one child. And I would encourage you with World Vision or Food for the Hungry or Compassion Booth out there to join the rest of the 7,000 of you who are reaching out to children. So as we close, my prayer for you is the same as the prayer I have for myself. And that is, yeah, you'll find your cause. You will find your passion and you will throw yourself into it with everything that you have. And in the midst of writing that letter, or in the midst of serving that meal, in the midst of that hug, in the midst of that prayer, suddenly, in a moment, the scripture says, in the twinkling of an eye, when you least expect it, a trumpet blast. And oh, church, we will all look up and we will see the sky roll back like a scroll and we'll go home, finally, finally home. home where there is no more hunger, home where there is no more sickness, home where there is no more death. In fact, home there isn't any tears anymore. The last tears will have been shed, and the tears will be wiped by God himself. In Revelation 21:4, God says, I will wipe the last tears from their eyes. Can you imagine that? The hands that knit you in your mama's womb are now waiting to wipe the tears from your eyes, having felt everything that you felt. The hands that picked you up when you fell down and just didn't think you could go on anymore, those hands are waiting to wipe the tears from your eyes. The hands that stretched out on that cross to take the nails to redeem you, those hands, loving you all this time, are waiting for the day when they can wipe the tears from your eyes. And I don't know about you, but I cannot wait. I cannot wait to run into the arms of my Lord, my Savior, my Redeemer, my King, my Jesus. And I intend to arrive panting into his arms. And I can't wait for him to wipe the tears from my eyes. Way too many tears for one lifetime. But oh, church, for you as well as for me, I pray that as he wipes the tears from our eyes, he notices he also needs to wipe the sweat from our brow. Because we lived the life he called us to live. We spoke up for those who couldn't speak for themselves. We were kind to the poor. We were gentle with the least of these until we were suddenly and wonderfully interrupted by heaven. LCBC, I pray this for me, and I pray this for you, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.